Valuable trained men were saved and ready to fight again. But the crews of Goering's planes were lost to him forever. The pace was too hot. Something was going haywire. The Nazis had to call time out. On a 2,000-mile front from Norway to France, the whole Nazi blitz program was being stalled because the RAF was still in the air. The shock troops were getting hoarse from singing, "We are sailing against England." The long-range German guns were getting hot from throwing shells across the channel. In public, Hitler assured the Germans, "Mr. Churchill tells his people that England will win, but I tell you that victory will belong to Germany." But in private, he sent for Goering, the boss of the Luftwaffe, and put him on the hot seat. Goering was told to do something and do it quick. So on August 30th, he ordered all-out attacks on inland aerodromes and industrial centers. Maybe he could knock out the RAF on the assembly line. And he adopted new tactics, too. More fighters and fewer bombers. Or maybe he just had fewer bombers to send. Anyway, those he did send were well protected. Fighters above at high altitudes. Fighters on both sides. Fighters in the front and in the rear. Fighters weaving in and out of the bomber formations.
Britain, winner of the first round, was ready. With higher morale and sharper defense, improved listening posts were set up all along the coast and warned of the enemy's approach before he left the continent. A quick flash from the control station to the fighter station, and pilots were on their way to meet the enemy while he was still over the channel. Day after day, out of sight, and almost out of sound of the watchers on the cliffs, 4, 5, and 6 miles above, the battles raged over the Dover area. The Dover area became known as Hell's Corner. By sheer weight of numbers, the enemy again and again broke through the coastal defenses. Inland to the airdrome. Aircraft plants. Munition factories and machine shops.
Hello, gunfire in the southeast. Right.
The workers kept on working, and the RAF kept on flying. These few men with wings alone in the sky, behind their motors and machine guns, were shooting down more than the Luftwaffe. They were smashing the whole Nazi plan of world conquest.
Johnny? 109 destroyed, Freddy, yes.
Oh, good show. How'd you get on, sir?
I had a wonderful party, thanks.
Are you all right? Did you get any of the batters?
Yes, I got a measurement 109 in Adonia.
Between August 24th and September 5th, 35 major attacks were launched. They cost the Germans 562 planes, while the British lost only 219 planes and saved 132 pilots. Invasion plans were going completely haywire. The Nazis were blind with rage. The German mind has never understood why free people fight on against overwhelming odds. Hitler now knew he was superior in every weapon except the weapon of spirit. So he told Goering, break that spirit, crush the people, crush the spirit of democratic life itself. Invasion now would have to wait. The Nazis would avoid the RAF and smash the great city of London into the rubble heap they had made of Warsaw and Rotterdam.
Could London take it? Even the people themselves didn't know the answer. The defenses they trusted in were London's hastily assembled anti-aircraft, the Ack-Ack guns, the balloon barrage which kept the raiders at high altitudes. The Royal Air Force, now down to its last reserves, and the plain, downright guts of the people. Sent more children out of the city. Tightened air raid precautions. Stationed more airplane spotters. Rehearsed firefighters. Moved into bomb shelters. They blacked out their city and carried on.
The first blow aimed to crush the British spirit came on September 7th.
Proof reports planes coming in.
Control room speaking.
Customers and staff will now take cover in the basement. Please do not run, but keep moving.
Keep down the stairs.